Of ethnic Albanian refugees continue to pour into Albania and Macedonia. Aid agencies say their condition is deteriorating. There are signs of malnutrition among some of the children, and the agencies are having severe problems accommodating the influx. They believe there may be as many as 100,000 more waiting to cross into Macedonia. The refugees arriving say the Serb forces in Kosovo are renewing their efforts to empty the province of its ethnic Albanian population. Janet Barry, BBC News.
The Indian Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee has submitted his resignation to the president after his government lost a vote of confidence in parliament. He said that his resignation had been accepted. The coalition government, which had been in power for 13 months, was ousted by a margin of just one vote. After 2 days of passionate debate, the actual vote was delayed by arguments over the voting rights of one MP. When the vote was taken through the electronic voting system, the government appeared to have lost by 7 votes, but some votes did not register, so it was retaken by ballot. The opposition Congress Party, led by Sonia Gandhi, the widow of Rajiv Gandhi, will now probably be invited to form a coalition. Pro-Indonesian militia in East Timor have gone on the rampage in the capital, Dili. Security forces say that at least 13 people were killed. Around 1,000 paramilitaries, some armed with automatic weapons, drove around the town shooting into the air and into houses. The violence broke out after a rally by the militiamen who want East Timor to remain under the control of Indonesia. And that's all from the BBC World Newsroom for the moment.
Hello once again. On looking at the latest satellite picture from Australasia, I was very glad to see that New Zealand still exists. We haven't seen much of it over the past couple of days. A complete sheet of cloud has covered the region as a big low pressure has brought in some wet and windy weather. Further north and east, it's still looking very threatening indeed across the Queensland coast. But I think down towards New Zealand, well, drier and brighter conditions on the way as this high pressure builds in, at least for a time, until the tail end of these fronts just brings more showery weather back in towards the South Island. You don't really need my interpretation to tell you it's very showery at the moment. Some heavy thunderstorms there brewing up across the islands of Indonesia. And here we can just show you what those thunderstorms can bring. 139 millimetres in just 30 hours or so. And it doesn't take many days like that to start clocking up the April average at 209 millimetres. More showers to come, but not right across the region. Certainly the northern half of the Philippines enjoying some decent weather over the next couple of days, I would have thought. Still very wet indeed across the southern parts of China. No great surprises when you see how much cloud there is, and it's now beginning to migrate across southern areas of both Korea and Japan. We can really bring you a wet story from China just about any day of the week at the moment. That's the way of it at this time of year, with these low pressures forming very readily. And as you see, they move off in something of a daisy chain pattern, but always leaving behind the next development area ready to bring more wet weather across the southern half of China. It's heat rather than anything else that's dominating the scene across the subcontinent just now. This area of cloud just likely to bring some showers in towards Colombo and also perhaps the far southeastern corner of India, but essentially it's dry, bright and sunny for many areas, as indeed it is across the northern parts of Africa, except the Algerian coast, where we've had quite a wet week of it there as well. Most of the showers you'll see concentrated across the equatorial zone, although don't forget that we have had some rain down in the far southeastern corner down towards Durban, for example, of South Africa, and it's likely to be that way over the next couple of days. Scandinavia not faring too well at the moment. I've pointed out Helsinki, but it's been particularly wet right across the central zone. No real surprises when I show you just how much cloud there has been streaming away, associated with quite a vigorous front. It's very warm air to the east, very cold air to the west, and that always generates really quite an active feature. And it looks as though it's going to stay that way over the next few days, with more wet weather moving into the northwestern quarter. The best of the sunshine certainly down across the area of the Mediterranean. That's the way it looks across much of the world. I'll leave you with a summary of the Americas. More wet weather to come for the northeast of the USA. More rain to come again for Colombia. Bye-bye. We'll be right back.
Now on BBC World, Crossing the Lines.
Pour la difficulté de retrouver les gens, il y avait 150 000 Müller, dont 10 000 Hans Müller.
New recruits to the International Red Cross are being shown round its museum in Geneva. They'll be told about all the things of which the Red Cross is justifiably proud. But the museum gives no clue to the dark secret at the heart of the world's oldest humanitarian organization, a secret which is only now being exposed.
Documents dating from the Second World War tell a story which shames the International Red Cross to this day. They reveal that although the ICRC was given secret information about Hitler's plan for the systematic genocide of the Jews, it chose to tell the world nothing. The International Committee of the Red Cross is accused of abandoning the Jews at the height of the Holocaust.
If you hear the Red Cross is coming, you hope, exaggeratedly possibly, that they'll do something. They'll give you food parcels, they'll prevent further transportations, they'll do something. In the end, they didn't.
Switzerland, a haven of neutrality in the maelstrom of Europe, is the home of the International Red Cross. From his village in the Swiss mountains, the Red Cross sent Maurice Rossel, then only 25, to Berlin for most of the last war. He's a witness to the institution's terrible failure during that period. Nowadays, he's a virtual recluse, surrounded by mementos, which he says symbolize the world's expectations of the International Red Cross. But in practice, he says, it has very little authority.
Vous m'avez posé la question, quels sont les moyens du CICR et qu'avez-vous comme autorité et que faites-vous, qu'avez-vous fait dans votre travail? Eh bien, un brouillon, un bloc, un crayon, et mon autorité s'arrête là.
C'est tout.
C'est tout. Aucune autre possibilité.
For the first time in this war, a newsreel cameraman brings to the screen a fragment from the daily work of the International Red Cross in its errands of mercy for prisoners of war. From the holds of neutral ships come those life-saving crates of parcels and medical supplies bearing the comfortable symbol, the Red Cross on the white ground. The flag of Switzerland with colors reversed, which over 80 years ago became the banner of organized humanitarianism on the field of war.
This is the popular image of the Red Cross, helping the victims of war, whoever they may be. It's remembered with deep gratitude by millions of POWs from both sides in the Second World War.
Without the Red Cross parcels, thousands would have died. People like myself were down to about six and seven stone.
These men know they owe their lives to the Red Cross. The survivors of several North of England regiments meet every year, and they remember their saviours.
News came through that we were going to receive a Red Cross parcel. And when we got them, our morale lifted sky high. You know, we thought, oh, this is not too bad, because we hadn't had any food at all. So we got these parcels, and it was a real Aladdin's cave, you know. There was about 12 inches by 10 by 5 deep. There was cream crackers, raisins, corned beef, Spam, coffee or tea, sugar, of course, and sardines.
But millions died in the concentration camps and ghettos, and the International Red Cross did nothing to help them. The survivors feel bitterly betrayed.
Looking back now, I must say, I look at them with a certain contempt. That Swiss had freely travelled to Germany, through Germany, before the war, during the war. And you must be blind not to know what's going on, because concentration camps were dotted all over the place, and they were right past railway lines. I mean, our last one was just on a railway line on one side and along a main road on the other. You couldn't miss it.
From its earliest days, the International Red Cross, discreet, neutral, was the fiefdom of Switzerland's wealthiest families, many of whom had strong ties to Germany. When Hitler came to power, these people didn't all think Nazism was so